Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Om Brahmanandam Param Sukhadam Kevalam Gyan Murtim Dvandvatitam Gagan Sadrisham Tattvamasyadi Lakshyam Ekam Nityam Vimalam Achalam Sarvadhi Sakshi Bhutam Bhavatitam Trigunarahitam Sadgurum Tam Namami Om. Relations to the Sadguru, who is Brahman, the giver of supreme bliss, embodiment of pure consciousness, one without a second, vast as the ether, infinite, eternal, beyond the three gunas and their modifications, the supreme preceptor. Yoga Vasistha, Vairagya Prakarana, Section 15. It's called Ahamkara Jugupsa. Jugupsa is a finding fault, gossiping against your own ego. That gossip starts when you get into satsanga. In the previous section, we focused on life. Life without enlightenment is full of vanity. And that I'm ending with an acronym of life. You remember, easy to remember, L-I-F-E. L, to find absolute love. That's your instinctive urge within every individual to love, to be loved. That's the first thing you experience in the world, nothing else. To find absolute love. I practice integral yoga in your life, integral yoga, not one-sided yoga. F, fullness. Purnam, that's the goal of your yoga practice, to attain fullness. Purnamadaha Purnamidam, that from which the whole world has emanated. From full, the world has come. And world remains always full in its essence. You take away the whole world, full remains. You don't understand it, you're a fool. All illuminations upon the earth emanate from the sun. And they are nothing but the sun. So if the illuminations move away, what remains is nothing but the sun. Let me give you another illustration. In a cinema show, all that show that arises is out of the screen. It's allegorical. And it's nothing but the screen. You go on screaming on the basis of illusion. And if all the show is taken away, what remains is nothing but the screen. The pure awareness which is playing all this role remains ever intact. And that's who you are. But between what has happened, a fake concept of I am has developed. It's called ahamkar, egoism. And majority of people, until you go through satsanga and develop certain purity of heart, ego is the guiding force. Everything you do is You look at the ego and say, you like it? Yes. Ego sits on your neck with two legs on your neck. Raga dvesha, attachment and hatred. If you go according to ego's hifim, the leg goes around your neck very lovingly. But go against your ego, the monkey pulls both legs and begins to crush your throat. Give you some joking picture. Now, therefore, we are entering into this highly poetic description and very profoundly insightful to enable you to learn about the weaknesses, the evils of your ego without being offended by it. Because ego has such an illusion that the moment anyone talks against your ego, you become exceedingly upset. Rama says, in vain ego has arisen out of ignorance. Avidya is the source of what we call asmita, egoism. And led by egoism, one develops raga, dvesha, things that you like, not what you like, what ego likes in you. You become attached to them. And what is not likable to the ego, you want to hate them. You are dictated by your ego. And this raga dvesha movement creates karmas. The soul gripped by karma enters into embodiment. Being embodied, you are not only harassed by the ego, but ego's evil nature manifesting in the form of fear of death. Since you have obeyed your ego for a long time, you have to pay for it. You live in this body with a constant alertness caused by fear of death. And that's so instinctive that most people don't even think of it. But each time you walk, something falls on your head. So anything happens, even a leaf coming to your nose, and you suddenly become upset. Because the whole body is constantly rigged in such a way that trying to remove death in every action. It's so natural that you don't even understand. But there are times, and most times, when people do get deeply involved with the fear of death. And no matter what you do, death is bound to happen. And not for you. If you have attained spiritual insight, death is not for you. Death is changing your cloth. Body is your cloth. One body didn't give you all the fulfillment. It's taken away. Another body will be given to you. But if you have attained enlightenment, no more bodies. No body body. Ego flourishes in vain. It doesn't allow a person to fulfill the purpose of life. And the purpose of life is the Purushartha. Four purposes of life. Dharma, ethical value. If you are pursuing a healthy style of life, then all your movement must be based upon dharma. That you should not rule out. In other words, don't go after success by hook or by crook, but go after success on the basis of dignity, spiritual dignity, ethical dignity, dharma. Led by dharma, now come to another level of Purushartha, Artha, material world. All the resources needed, work for it. God has already given you this best of resources, your body, your mind, your intellect. Now try to understand how can you utilize your resources. And whatever you need, the divine creation is ready to present to you based on your effort. And if your effort blends with grace, then you attain amazing success, amazing wealth. But if your wealth has been earned on the basis of dharma, it will allow your heart to be magnanimous. You will utilize your wealth to accelerate your spiritual evolution. But if you have not, then you're more concerned in holding on to wealth, multiplying the wealth, watching the wealth show. What's happening to the economic situation? Next is called karma. Karma refers to vital value of life. Social value is easy to understand. How you are related to society. How to interrelate with human beings, and in turn, what type of successor you are creating out of your body. In other words, life of grihastha ashram. Kama. To understand more, it's called putreshana, vitteshana, lokeshana. Three types of desire. Desire to have progeny, sons, daughters, and so forth. That's putreshana. Vitteshana, that have lot of money so that you don't have to worry about. And lokeshana. Whatever you do should go viral. Praise, power. But if you are following the Purushartha, all these are normal. To have ethical value, material value, social value. All these values should enrich you in a way that you move towards God realization, liberation. Liberation is the spiritual value of life. So these are steps culminating in spiritual value, moksha, liberation. If you are following this whole process, you are fulfilling the purpose of your life. And if you are fulfilling it, then you will move in your life with immense dignity, security, peace, happiness, and so forth. All blessings will flow in your heart. In order to understand that, read the stories of sages and saints. But Ahamkara will not allow you to have these purposes of life fulfilled. Ahamkara puts a termite into each step. When it comes to dharma, many will say, who knows there is God or not? Science has not discovered anything like that. So the general policy is get on by hook or by crook until you get honor. When you get on and you become successful, people begin to honor you. That's the masses. I will not go into that detail. And finally, you present yourself the most honest person in the world. Honor and honest. I'm talking the demoniac way. That's not the lesson of life. But that's what majority of people don't care. Anyhow, by adopting any purpose, any method, by hook or by crook, satisfy the demand of your ego. That's not real life. It's a life of aberrated life of misery. This Ahamkara, Rama says, is a great Shatru. Shatru term is enemy. Sha relates to all that is blessed, goodness, good things coming in your life, auspicious. And Tru, that opposes all auspicious developments within you. If I go into deeper explanation, Tru relates to affecting your three aspects of consciousness. Seer, seen, and sight. Mind gripped by anger looks at you, turn yourself towards yourself, you're angry. Why didn't you revenge on that person before? Angry with something that happened 5 years before, something that happened even in your early days. So one type of anger, that's one aspect of Shatru. Next, your concept of the world is aberrated. You don't see the world, you are seeing it according to the color of your glass. Your glass refers to vasanas, subtle desires. The world has amazing things to fill your mind with immense peace and joy. Just the sky is enough to blow your head away. But if the mind is filled with vasanas, subtle desires, you cannot have that experience. So, your attitude towards yourself, your attitude towards the world, and your attitude towards your experiences of pleasure and pain that go on in daily life, these three are obstructed by an inimical development within yourself, led by ignorance. The name is egoism, asmita. Egoism creates the illusion of the world process. The ingredients of this illusion, speaking allegorical language, you develop in your mind, I will be happy if I get that particular object. I will be happy if I get that particular post, particular job, or whatever. You have a target for your mind. That in itself is not the reality. Then, ego has evolved. These are the means. If I have them, I will acquire. Called sadhya. And also ego has its own interpretation of what is desirable, what is not desirable. So we're living in a world as viewed by your ego, and you don't have really any time to enjoy who you are. Predicament, and in divine plan, everyone is given a little relief in deep sleep. The pressure of ego is lifted during the night. all things that were so important to you, led by your ego, they move away and you don't miss them. Rather, you become very refreshed when you have real good sleep. Pointing to the fact that in reality, deepest level, you have nothing to do with your ego. And if you were to look for your ego, what it is, you will not find it. You cannot catch a reflected moon in water, no matter how much it may shine. Ego compels the soul to pursue illusory pleasures and leads to the soul to amazing networks of miseries. Egoism affects your physical body, leading to various diseases. When you have, suppose you are sitting in a wonderful situation, it's very beautiful, picturesque setting of nature, and suddenly your mind remembers, so someone met me but didn't say good morning. That was relaxed. No, not relaxed. Look at your nose, it was breathing freely. Now it's not taking the oxygen. You're depriving yourself of all wonderful things that surround you. Who did it? Ego. Egoism. All this I'm saying easily, simply, but that's what an aspirant has to understand. And understanding that I am not the ego and therefore I have to work in a way that, first point, your ego goes through three stages, tamasic, rajasic, sattvic. First, lift the ego from tamasic state. Tamasic state, ego simply stays in a state of passivity. And it appears like someone has attained a great enlightenment. It's a fake enlightenment. That state makes you just like an animal. Animals don't have to think. They simply go through the instinct. Tamasic state of mind, that mind suddenly cannot recognize what project you have, what possibilities you have. How should you allow your life to flow, to fulfill the purposes of your soul? If that does not come in, the tamasic ego, and also another aspect of tamasic ego, it becomes demoniac. Your mind, you are so bored, the only thing that can give some excitement is to see something terrible. And that aspect, if I tell, many people will be upset. People will go after killing animals for their food. Same animals that are so wonderful, cute, joyous, but when you go hunting them down, you don't look at all those. All that you see, how much flesh is coming. That's tamasic state mind coming to a little more aberrated level that human beings enjoy all over the world. That's the source of terrorism. There's not a single day when somewhere whole set of people are not terrorized every moment. That comes from tamasic state of mind. And that's what scriptures all over the world describe as devils, demons. And some people are haunted by demons, not realizing the demon is you. all those sattva, rajas, tamas, all those gunas are within every individual. And you have to recognize them and allow the higher purity to enter and remove those gunas or sublimate. Rajasic ego displays itself through distracted pursuit of things, going after so many things. Many people in the world who are not tamasic, they are normally recognized as good people, civilized people. But their life is filled with constant planning. How can you bring excitement? Take a trip this way, take a trip that way. And thinking of, oh, future is coming when people could go and make a trip to Mars. How exciting it would be. Climbing a mountain has become an old fashion. So no longer about Everest. And we go into another level, sattvic ego. Sattvic ego, you begin to hear your praises when you do good things. And it relaxes you, makes you so joyous that you become extremely virtuous. But, it's a big but. All that virtue does not make you humble. It creates in you a strange, inflated ego. That's what the scriptures give you. Big demons like Ravana, Kansa, and they had done many good karmas. They were personalities with many powerful, generous deeds. But in spite of, after all the generous deeds, say for example, Ramayana, you have the story of Pratapa Bhanu. He was a very righteous king and so forth. He is led to meet an enemy in a forest who has trapped him with illusion. He says, I am such a big sage. Since the creation, I have not changed my body. I'm such a big yogi. Ask any boon and I will give you. Prasabhyanu says, make me immortal. And absolutely powerful. Now, if you had really done virtuous deeds, to acts of charity, you wouldn't be saying that. So, in spite of all those things he did, turns out to be a big demon. I'm just giving you some of these little points to understand how the stories are given in scriptures. Ahamkara brings about physical troubles, which I have explained. Ego creates disbalance in the harmony of your humors. Vata, pitta, kapha, you cannot be humorous. It gives rise to lots of mental stress, klishta vrittis, the thought waves that nourish egoism, attachment, hatred, fear of death. And they give rise to lots of worries and anxieties. Sometimes they are just imaginary, but sometimes they are not imaginary. You are placed in difficult circumstances, led by your karma. Rama says, Ahankar is my rogue. I'm using the rogue as a humor. Rogue is disease. English word is rogue. It's very closely related. with this type of sensitive understanding about the enemy, egoism, I'm not able to enjoy eating, drinking, or any pleasure of the world. This haunts my mind. Subtle point behind it. Sarvam duhukam vivekina. If vivek begins to develop discriminative understanding that ego is not me, that all things going on are going to flatten the ego, leading to lots of terrible experiences. When that begins to develop on one side, you are not attracted to objects of the world, rather you find negativity in all. But this is not a psychological case of seeing everything negative. But it's a healthy state, just like a doctor sees so many patients as they are all relaxing on their beds. A doctor won't fall for it. He will not relax in bed. I'm joking, but to give you a simple way to understand. Sensitive mind sees the world, enjoying, satisfying their ego. And they are preparing for internal restlessness. And that is not a joyous picture. That's not a good news to break. So anityam asukham lokam, all the pleasures of the senses are transient. Sarvam duhukam vivekina, just as a hunter creates a snare to trap deer. In the same way, ego has created a trap. Led by ego, the soul experiences as if being driven to something, a dark cell. There are mountains that are filled with thorny trees. Ego is like that mountain. All that grows out of your egoism, they are not fruit-giving trees, but lots of thorns. And even if they give you certain flowers and you pick them, your fingers show. Get pinched. Egoism acts like Rahu to swallow up the moon of serenity. The moon of serenity that would give you real joy, but you can't maintain it. Your ego will rob you of that moon. Ego has only head. The Rahu, but the tongue slips out of their head and grabs. That's a joking process. When I say ego, try to also understand what is being negated and described as evil is not your ego, egoism. Without ego, you can't live. So therefore, don't become too concerned with some people study scriptures and they don't want to use I because they think they have become very advanced. Even if you shut out I from your language, ego is there. Who is dictating you to do that? So it doesn't matter in your expression, in your saying, I did it. If you have cooked your certain food, delicious food or whatever, and you declare, I did it, there is no egoism in it. You are just expressing the fact, I did it. While doing that, you may hold in your heart joyousness, a kind of... The mother says to the children, I did it, look, all this I did for you. So it seems egoistic. But there is no real awareness is not to highlight the ego. The person who is using the word ego or expressing I knows that he is playing with words. In other words, sages exercise their ego in fun. And ignorant people exercise their egolessness again in fun. In other words, they don't practice egolessness, even though they may go on trying to say, I'm very humble, I'm the humblest person. Ego is like frost. To destroy the lotuses of divine qualities. You may have done lots of good deeds, but one day you show up your ego. All the good deeds are forgotten. That's what happens in practical life. That's what in families quarrel happens. So many good deeds have been done, years and years. But one day in right time, tea was not given. You should go to hell. So, all your good qualities are blown away by inflated ego. Ego deprives you from developing equal vision. Equal vision implies looking at the world. Here it has many stages of equal vision. I'm just giving you more practical type. Looking at the world without the color of egoistic attitude. In other words, you could find inspiration from blossoming flowers, from trees, lush trees, from the sky, from the breeze that blows. There are so many ways to find. God is everywhere. The sun reflecting in so many jars. If you are a grown-up person, seeing that, says it's the same sun. That's called equal vision. He sees the same sun in every jar, but he will not drink from every jar. You recognize the two stages. The real spirit, the essence in every individual is God. But that doesn't mean that you should just communicate with all types of people abruptly. So that's the quality of being samadrishti. Samadrishti has not a simple virtue. But that samadrishti does not develop if egoism develops. Qualitative things are presented to you, led by your ego, you will not turn to them. Moha-based vision, and that I don't have to describe it, the world is filled with all those experiences. Just as winter, the weather, removes the clouds. Ahamkara is like winter weather. It removes the clouds of, cloud here is in a positive way, clouds of shama, serenity, daya, compassion, generosity and all divine virtues. Therefore, Rama says, I cannot live with this ego. If ahamkara is destroyed, or abandoned, or renounced, many evils will move away. The evil of Dehabhiman, identity with the body, I am the body. Mamata, these things are mine. Ahamta, mamata, and many negative movements of the mind, they will not occur, they will not be there if egoism does not dominate your mind. I am not Ramchandra. If you take it literally, you will be confused. So Rama himself is saying, I'm not Ramachandra. I have no desire for objects. I have nothing to do with the mind. I want to stay abiding in the self, free of all bitterness and animosity, like Buddha. Yoga Vasistha was written after Buddha's incarnation and his. So there are many reflections of Buddha's teachings. Of course, Buddha's teachings are again nothing but the Upanishadic teachings. All that I have enjoyed, eating, drinking, all the rituals I have performed, led by the ego, all the karmas have I generated, all this is tuch, all this is vanity, ends up with big zero. What's essential, what's purposeful, is to become free of egoism. So if you are asking yourself, how much have I attained? The answer is, how much you have effaced yourself. That's what's brought out in scriptural. The disciple says, when will I be free? And they went, and the guru says, when your eye ceases to. O sage, I have renounced my ego. I have renounced all agitations related to ego. It is ego that causes all forms of agitation. I'm talking about egoism. Agitations created by your body, your senses, the objects around you, and all details, all that causes agitation in a person. The subtle root behind all this is egoism. And egoism is due to non-discrimination. Your understanding is not clear. Who am I? Are you really helping yourself, or are you helping the ego? You cannot distinguish between the two. If you are helping yourself, you are following the path of Shreya, path of liberation. But you are helping your ego, you are moving into the world process, because ego will never be fulfilled. It doesn't have a reality. Ego's attainments are like the rumblings of clouds, the rumbles that break down rocks, nothing else to do. Ego rumbles in vain. But you go through the crashing and all those apathies, miseries. Ego is a demoniac spirit, speaking allegorical language, that has created a garland based on the thread of Krishna, craving. The thread of Krishna, that passes through so many births and deaths and so many attainments of the world. All attainments, they are like beads. Krishna is going through all of them. And that has become your necklace. That Trishna must move away, that's the goal of life. Instead of creating Trishna, go after Krishna. All the three aspects are divine. The subject, who am I, that's divine. The object, the world, God's expressions. All your experiences, they are like the breeze blowing over trees. Sheetal Manda Sugandha, they are all divine. When it comes to that, it's Krishna. Trishna becomes Krishna. But you have to go through the spiritual movement. With that understanding, to turn away from Trishna and all its terrible consequences to Krishna, absolute joy. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.